The Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
It always brings me joy to bring greetings each Sunday morning to see you all here joined together to worship in this sacred space, and to know that there are others, hundreds of others, who will join us virtually this week as we worship together. The love of God welcomes us, the grace of Christ awaits us, and the joy of the Spirit enfolds us today as we worship. So to guests who are worshiping with us for the first time, we're so glad that you've joined us. I hope you'll take one of the guest cards, which is in the pew rack in front of you, and fill that out so that we'll know that you were with us and we can let you know how glad we were and how honored we were with your presence. You can put that card in the offering plate as it's passed later in the service, or give it to one of the ministers as you leave today. It is this lived faith that we share that connects us to one another, and it opens us up each week to embody beautiful belonging, and that fills us with deep love and joy and peace. Please join me as we read together our call to worship. Beloved children of God, in supplication and prayer, with intercessions and with thanksgiving,
we come to worship God.
In hope and in humility, with joy and with concerns,
we come to worship God.
In faith and in uncertainty, with questions and with conviction,
let us worship God.
Thank you. us say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, the living God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In humility and faith, then, let us confess our sin to God as we read the prayer of confession aloud. Holy God, you command us to love one another, yet we hold grudges and refuse to work for peace. You command us to care for all of creation, yet we neglect the earth. You command us to walk in the ways of Jesus, yet we too often walk our own way. Forgive us, O God. Guide us as we work toward a new heaven here on earth. Lead us to reconciliation and a vision for your beloved community as we share your love with people everywhere. If anyone is in Christ, that person is part of a new creation. The old things have gone away and everything becomes new and fresh. So friends, receive this good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. As we have once again confessed our sins and our shortcomings, and as we have once again been reminded of God's grace, which is always sufficient for us, let us now share the peace that can come from that forgiveness. The peace that comes from God, the peace that roots all of us in this living community, the peace that can transform our lives and our world. Would you share this peace as you stand and turn and say those ancient words, "The peace of Christ be with you," and respond, "and also with you." Let us stand. Thank you.
open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Friends, hear these words from Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
Our scripture lesson comes from the book of 1 Samuel. Listen closely for God's word to us today. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do, and you shall anoint for me the one whom I name to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him trembling and said, "Do you come peaceably?" He said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely his anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him, for the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. He said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel, and Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers, And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Samuel then set out and went to Ramah. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Saul's kingship has been a failure. And the days of his reign are numbered, and his disappointing legacy has been sealed for posterity. Before he is even dethroned, though, God sends the prophet Samuel on an undercover mission to anoint a new king for Israel. So we step into the story today as Samuel approaches Bethlehem and the family of Jesse. At Samuel's command, Jesse brings all of his sons to be sanctified by Samuel. And when they arrive, Samuel can't take his eyes off of Eliab. Eliab looks presidential, handsome, chiseled jaw, full, thick head of hair, broad shoulders, taller than the rest, a stately, dignified young man destined for royalty. But the voice of God comes to Samuel. Do not look upon his appearance or on the height of his stature. I have rejected him. The Lord does not see as mortals see. The Lord looks on the heart. One by one, Samuel moves down the line of Jesse's sons. Nope, too short. Nope, shoulders too slouched. Nope, nose too big. Never get elected, that nose. Nope, eyes too close together. Nope, doesn't have that it factor. He comes to the line of these seven freshly scrubbed young men, but nothing is sparking Samuel's discernment. God hasn't inspired him to anoint Eliab, and none of the rest even measure up to this rejected one. Are all these your sons? This is all the sons you have here, Jesse? Samuel says. Jesse replies, well, there is one more, but he's keeping sheep. He's what? He's out there, he's keeping sheep. Jesse, come again. I'm a trifle deaf in this ear. You need to speak a little clearly. He's a shepherd. He's out in the fields. He's keeping the sheep. I didn't think it'd be possible for you to want him. Samuel commands Jesse to send for this young shepherd. His entourage even refuses to sit until they bring him. And when they return with David, Samuel sees a promising young man. Scripture says he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. The Lord says to Samuel that very moment, rise and anoint him, for this is the one. But didn't the Lord just spend the better part of a minute, 5 verses ago, telling Samuel, do not look on his appearance? The Lord does not see as mortals see. Well, they look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. How could Samuel be expected to distinguish between two hearts of handsome young men without even knowing them? So here's the rub. I believe this contradiction is too obvious. God is inviting us to look behind the curtain of this drama. Yes, both Eliab and David are attractive, albeit in different ways. Eliab's height recalls Saul's tall stature. So it could be that our storyteller is trying to teach us that conventionally impressive physical attributes don't equal success. Looking the part doesn't always mean someone is qualified. David, though ruddy and handsome, does not make a royal first impression, apparently. He comes from the lowly fields, from the margins, if you will, from the margins of power, certainly. But David does prove later on that he's up to the task. We remember how he slayed the giant Goliath, a sharp shooting young soldier. He's courageous. He's musically gifted. Saul invites him into his court to play for him, not knowing that he's been anointed to be king. He's also a brilliant poet, as we see from the Psalms attributed to David, a Psalm of David, remember? He's a shrewd military leader, as we see from his many conquests, successes on the battlefield. David has a lot of what we call heart. As we say, that kid's got heart. Yet for a time, Saul also had heart. 6 chapters ago, we read, quote, God gave Saul a new heart, and all Samuel's signs were fulfilled that day. Then in the sequel to 1 Samuel, popularly titled 2 Samuel, we see David commit the shocking act of raping Bathsheba, murdering her husband Uriah, and attempting to cover it all up. So it may be that all this talk of who is and who isn't fit to be king, who is handsome and who is ruddy, is the narrator's way of hinting that though David will be Israel's greatest king, he will disappoint us. Now, the prophet Samuel warned the people about starting this whole business of having kings at all. You may remember in 1 Samuel 8, this is one of the best passages in all of Scripture. I just love this passage. It's 1 Samuel 8, Samuel's listening to the people talk about how they want a king so they can be powerful like the other nations, because the other nations have kings, and so they must have a king too so that they can be powerful like the other nations. And Samuel's just listening to them drone on and on about, we want a king. And then he says, all right, you want a king? I'll give you a king. But here's what's going to happen. He's going to take your children and put them in the military. He's going to have you refashioning your favorite plowshares into swords. He's going to take the best land, and he's going to take the best of your livestock. And he's going to subject you to those TurboTax commercials. You're going to be trying to watch the NCAA tournament, but every commercial is going to be TurboTax commercial. And then from then on, throughout 1 and 2 Samuel, the narrator is uneasy about kingship. The whole time we're talking about kings, and they rise and they fall, they impress us, but then they disappoint us in monumental fashion. I believe 1 Samuel may even be a clever argument against kingship. So why does this text then appear now in this time in the church year? I've puzzled over this for months now. What is this doing here in Lent, of all places? Couldn't we have put this somewhere in like the summer Sundays? Could preach on 1 Samuel like in July or something. Why is it in the season of Lent? Why all this political talk of anointing kings for Israel thousands of years ago? And what has any of this to do with us? I wonder if it has everything to do with God preparing us to welcome a disappointing king. God judging our judgment about who deserves to wield power. Both Saul and David remind us that even when we anoint and celebrate the finest, handsomest people to lead us, they will fall short of God's dream. They will disappoint us. I remember hearing the refreshing story of a politician in West Virginia. Stephen Smith was running for governor in 2020. Not to exercise partisan power, he said, but he wanted to return power to the disinherited people of West Virginia. And at one rally, there was an elder man there who said he was so inspired to come here, this new, young, handsome candidate, that he came. He hadn't been to a rally like this or a political event since 1960, he said, because this new fella reminded him of John F. Kennedy. That was the last time he went to anything like this. And he had compared Smith to the charismatic Kennedy, and then Smith stunned the room by saying this: "One thing I can tell you is I will disappoint you." He lost in the primary. I remember when I came here, I was talking with someone came up to me, approached me, and they said, "You know, I just want you to know, I think you're going to do a great job, but I just want to tell you, I've hoped in pastors before, but I had a pastor disappoint me and break my heart once upon a time many years ago, and so I decided back then that I wasn't going to hope in the pastor anymore. My only hope was going to be in God." And you know how that made me feel? Relieved. So relieved. Why is this here in Lent? I believe the scriptures point to this story now in order to prepare us for the cross. 1 Samuel helps set the stage for an unsettling realization to come over all of us, that the most disappointing man that ever lived was the only one who could save us, and did. Do you remember how disappointing Jesus was? At first, even before he was born, the scriptures prophesied he would have no comely appearance, no physical attributes that we should desire him. He disappointed John the Baptist. You remember John the Baptist thought he was going to be the one to save Israel, restore him, Israel to the kind of Davidic majesty, King David all over again. But no, Jesus, he even sent reporters to Jesus. "Are you the one? Are we supposed to wait for another?" Jesus disappointed Peter. He kept telling the disciples, "I'm going to be arrested and I'm going to suffer at the hands of the leaders. I'm going to be crucified." Peter said, "No way. That's not going to happen to you." And Jesus politely responded, "Get behind me, Satan." Jesus ran a failing campaign as a public speaker, started strong, multitudes, but then the people kept leaving, and the crowd got smaller and smaller. He was perhaps most remembered as a public speaker for overturning the tables in the temple and publicly shaming the most elite religious leaders. "Woe to you, religious leaders, hypocrites," he said, "in public, for you are like whitewashed tombs, which outwardly appear beautiful, but within are full of dead people's bones and all uncleanness." That'll get you a loss in the primary. He disappointed those watching him from the cross. He saved others, but he can't save himself. He disappointed one of those crucified with him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." He even disappointed people after he was raised from the dead. Cleopas and his partner are walking to Emmaus, speaking with Jesus. They don't know he's Jesus. They're walking beside him. They haven't recognized his face or his voice. We had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. In this time of great disappointments in leaders and politicians and pastors, disappointment in our communities, disappointment in ourselves, I find only the greatest hope that the most disappointing person that ever lived exposes our judgment about who is and who is not disappointing, who has come to save us from our sins and save us from our own miscues and judgments and mischaracterizations. I read the news now. It's disappointing. But I remember 10 years ago, I was reading the news. It was disappointing. I remember 10 years before that, I was reading the news. It was so disappointing. But all along the way, encounters with the risen Christ through the people and the places where Jesus said he would be, I lift up my heart. And lift up yours. Where did Jesus say we could find our hope? On the margins. With the poor. With the disinherited. And with the disenfranchised. In the places where people suffer. In the places where disappointment hovers over people's minds and hearts like a cloud. And yet Christ is there. And so we find in this suffering that it produces endurance, and that this endurance produces character, and that this character produces hope, and this hope does not disappoint us. He has a name. His name is Jesus. He is alive, and he is with us. Thanks be to God. Friends, I invite you to come closer to the heart of God, the body of Christ, by the waters of baptism, or by statement of faith, as you come and join a new community, this local expression of Christ's body in the world. I invite you too to consider, if you sense your heart being moved to pastoral ministry and ordination, we'd love to share that journey with you. Come let us know that this is how the story of your life is turning out. As the Spirit comes close to each one of us and draws us closer to the heart of God, may the Spirit rest on our hearts, strengthen us, renew us, and reveal to us a still more excellent way. Now may we stand and sing together.
Spirit of our God, the language of your Let's join together in prayer as a congregation. Thank you, God, for loving us. Please lead each one of us to accept your gift of grace and salvation. We pray, Lord, to bless all our missionaries and their work that they do for you. We pray for ourselves, Lord, that you will guide each one of us in service for you. Lead us, Lord, to truly worship you as your congregation and as individuals. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You may notice that the chancel is a little larger than usual. Less space for me to stand, anyway. That's because last evening, the Asheville Symphony Orchestra was here, filling up the house with beautiful music. I'm grateful to Tate and Emily and all of our custodial staff and those who welcomed the symphony here. We're so glad that we could offer this space for our community in this way. The excitement of last night was probably rivaled by the excitement of Friday night. We had a parents' evening out. And I guess what happens in the gym stays in the gym, because I didn't hear any stories about it. But I'm very grateful to those who led that event. Thank you for welcoming our children and giving our parents a little bit of time to go downtown and have some fun with each other. So thank you for all the ways that you've opened this beautiful church to our community and to our congregation. I also want to welcome back our Puerto Rico team. Thank you to Kristen Kirby and the team. They have been in Puerto Rico doing hurricane relief construction for the past week, and they've back home safely. I'm so grateful for your work and the mission that you carry on in Puerto Rico with our dear brothers and sisters and neighbors in Christ. Also, finally, today's the deadline to sign up or RSVP for the luncheon next Sunday following worship. This luncheon will be an informational luncheon about our congregation's endowment. If you'd like to learn more about how you can participate in the endowment, I invite you to RSVP by today. You can call the church office, leave a voicemail, or you can email Heather Swanson at hswanson@fbca.net. Now receive this benediction. God be in your head and in your understanding. God be in your eyes and in your looking. God be in your mouth and in your speaking. God be in your heart and in your thinking. And God be at your end and at your departing, now and always. Amen.